This is Green Machine Comics. Hey, we're going to do our weekly comic wrap-up. We've got the holiday Yule log in the background. I don't know if you guys can see it, but so we're going to go through some comics. It's kind of hard for me to see over this.
Sorry, man.
That's okay, man. So first comic we're going to talk about is the TMNT Holiday Special, which is actually quite good. I was a little surprised. I mean, it's sort of the usual Christmas Carol, Dickens Christmas Carol with
past, present, and future.
Yeah, Splinter being visited by the three ghosts and
Splinter, huh?
Yes, Splinter, because he's currently the head of the Foot Clan, puts him opposite the head of the Hamada Clan. So you know, he's sort of opposite his sons, but it was actually good and kind of heartwarming. But you know, I have a soft side for TMNT, so I've never hidden that.
Now, I gotta ask, like, a lot of holiday specials are kind of non-canonical. They're just kind of off to the side of their own story. Does that feel like it's gonna branch off from the rest of it?
It is tied into the current run of TMNT ongoing.
Yeah.
Excuse me. Next, we're gonna talk about Marvel Comics Spider-Geddon number 5. But before we talk about Spider-Geddon number 5, we need to talk about the nice tribute on the books right now.
I'm trying to see if I can zoom in on that.
Yeah, and so the top of each of Marvel books, at least for this week, maybe for the whole month, I think, says Stan Lee, and it's got his timeline right there.
Oh, and back of it, too.
Yeah, yeah. Well, the back, so the thing about it, all the backs are black except for this one. The current Spider-Geddon number 5 is the only one that's got Stan's soapbox not on the inside of the book, but on the outside of the book.
That's which, me clapping.
I don't know if it was... if it was on purpose. What I'm gonna read what he says, just because. He says, "Hang loose, heroes. Now that I've got your ear, I'm not letting go. Our first tintibulating topic is gonna be the Marvel philosophy. Whenever I get together with any of you frantic ones, the first question posed is usually, what are you fellas really trying to do in your mags? What message are you pushing? Is the whole Marvel series just a big put-on, or are you trying to tell us something? Are you actually serious about your characters? Do you really believe in them? Etc. Well, just between us, we believe in our Cavorton characters a lot. A lot more than we believe in some people we know. And we do have a motive, a purpose behind our mags. That purpose is plain and simple. To entertain you. We think we've found the best formula of all. We merely create the type of fanciful yarns that we ourselves enjoy. And if we like them, you ought to like them, too. After all, you're our kind of people, too. Now then, in the process of providing offbeat entertainment, if we also do our bit to advance the cause of intellectualism, humanitarianism, and mutual understanding, and to toss in a little swinging satire at you in the process, that won't break our collective heart one tiny bit. That's it, Pussycat. Thanks for listening."
Really? Wow.
So it's done in the old style Stan soapbox, and it's really quite touching. That's pretty much we did a lot of Marvel books because we wanted to see this tribute on the cover when we show them this week anyways. So the first one we're reviewing is Spider-Geddon number 5. And Spider-Geddon number 5 was quite good. Quite good. Marvel, I think you should be paying attention to this event because you wrap this event up nicely. I had a good time with this event.
Good.
The run was not painful.
Good.
Unlike the Infinity Wars event, which was really painful. But I think that Marvel is doing the whole event fatigue for its fans, at least for me. I had some event fatigue, even with this one. There were a few characters that were sort of rushing off to do their own thing, and their stories didn't quite matter. But the main Spider-Geddon event was still pretty fun. So this one wraps it up quite nicely. There's a giant fight. I can't say more than that because I will spoil it. Oh, and And you know from the last book, right. I mean, the Scarlet Spider dies again. Again. I don't know what number he's on. 27?
The Spider-Verse.
27, 28, 28 deaths? So he dies again. Okay, and that's going to lead us into Superior Spider-Man number one.
Yeah.
I'm a little disappointed that there's no Superior Octopus continuing. He's continuing on with Superior Spider-Man, but I would love to see that character come back.
I think you predicted that, too.
Yeah.
I think anyone could predict that one.
It's kind of a bummer.
Yeah.
So in this book, he's back to San Francisco and back to dealing with his new super team that he created out of villains, didn't he?
Yeah.
He made them out of villains.
The ones on the bus, right?
Yeah.
Oh, man.
And, like, one of them is, like, a reanimated corpse that runs around with, like, a shovel, and I can't remember his name. They're weird characters. It's a weird super team, but it works, and... You know, he's doing the usual, like, professor thing in between navigating, like, you know, an ex-girlfriend that he's been hanging around and he probably shouldn't. And, you know, struggling with his own ego. So all of that happens in this book, and it's a really good time. I have a good time with Superior Spider-Man. I can't wait to read more. I still want to see more of that Superior Octopus. I don't know how they're going to do that, but it'd be nice.
It sounds like they left off, or they picked up right where Superior Octopus left off.
They totally did.
Nice.
Right where he left off. It was like, he didn't even take a break. He just flew right into it.
Good.
And then we got to go over the Scotty Young variant, which I like so much. I love the Scotty Young stuff, and this variant is so cute. Although, let's compare. He could have at least given him the arms.
That would have been nice, but still pretty good. That's definitely a Scotty Young.
Yeah. Next, we're going to talk about Tank Girl, Action Alley. And for those of you that don't know, Tank Girl was, God, I don't remember how long or when she started. But
I only remember the movie.
Tank Girl is a very not politically correct, profane, loudmouth, foul sort of hero, I guess is the nicest way... She's got a mouth on her. Yeah, she's very punk. She hangs out with Jet Girl. Obviously, Tank Girl has a tank. And in this one, she gets a super tank. It's great. But this story is a little confusing. I did like the art, and I want to know more before I can really totally recommend it. If you are a Tank Girl fan, if you like stuff that's not very politically correct, because it's really not, then this is right up your alley. I had a good time with it. I want to see more before I make more jokes. Like, it is very not politically correct, but, you know, it's Tank Girl. There are always dong jokes and other weird stuff.
Okay.
So, yeah, there you go. All
right.
Next is The Defenders. And, you know, I mean, like, I really like the sort of... I don't know what style of art this is, but it feels very 90s. And I've liked all the build-up to this, which it looks extra classy with the Stan Lee.
They look super classy.
So this, they've been building up, what is it, 6 books, and they did like 2 a week.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So this is the big fight when the Defenders finally come together, and we're, you know, there's the Devil Hulk, and there's Doctor Strange, and Silver Surfer, and Namor, and I had a good time with it. However,
uh-oh.
I'm gonna preface this. I had a good time with it, however, the big bad they faced, that was over relatively quick. There's probably still going to be a little bit of fallout, but they built it up over those issues, and now it's just done. So, whatever. And then on top of that, the storyline is a bit confusing. It's not as easy and as flowy as I'd like it to be. It was a little cumbersome here and there,
mm-hmm.
but I still had a good time with it. I'm anxious to see more. I'm not totally sold on the art still. Like, it does have a very 90s feel. It doesn't mean it's necessarily my cup of tea. I go back and forth on it, and I'm not quite sure what it is. Like, some pages I'm like, whoa, this is really cool, and then other pages I'm like, I don't know. I will say that the other issues were drawn with this style, that's on the cover. Like, the actual issues were full with that style. And I think they swapped artists, because the inside is a little different. It's still a very 90s feel. I like it. I don't know. I want to see more from the Defenders before I can heartily recommend them, but I think they're off to a good start.
Take that as a win, man.
Okay. So now we're going to talk about Nightwing. So if you don't know, We've talked about it before, but we're going to say Dick Grayson is now Rick Grayson. He's had a traumatic brain injury. So he pretty much gave up being Nightwing, and then some cops and a fireman sort of found his hideout, his secret lair that he tried to burn down, and they found all his costumes, and they've taken up the mantle. And it's been pretty good. There's one cop who is pretty much, like, he looks like Dick Grayson, and he's made a couple blunders, but he's the closest to the original. There is, like, another cop who, she is too gung-ho, and there is another cop who he is too gun-shy, and then there is another cop who is also, like, I mean, like, he's pretty good. He's, like, about the middle ground, and he's my favorite. And, oh, he's not a cop, he's a fireman. Yeah, and he's got an axe. And he's on the cover here, and he is currently my favorite of all the new Nightwings, which is weird to say, because my favorite is still the original Nightwing, but this is a good second runner-up. And so they're obviously going up against the Scarecrow, which if you couldn't tell last time with the Nightwing on the wooden things, obviously they're going up against the Scarecrow. So this is a good read. This is a strong showing for Nightwing. I'm still kind of iffy about this art, though, too. The art inside the book... It hasn't fully sold me, and I know I'm a little critical on art lately, but I don't know. It's kind of weird. I think it's appropriate for what they're dealing with, though, which is the Scarecrow gassing the city. And the Scarecrow himself, he's not doing the usual thing where he gasses and everyone's scared. He's doing the opposite. He's gassing people, and they're not afraid. And not being afraid means they're saying, I'm not afraid of you, and they're, like, fighting each other. And it's pretty messed up. And so that's pretty much where we start off, and it's still putting Rick Grayson on a collision course with the new Nightwings, and we'll see how it turns out. Next is a book I love to talk about. I love talking about this. Whenever it comes in, I sit there and I think, you know, I got to cycle some of these books. I can't talk about the same books every week. However, we always talk about the Punisher. And it's because both the art and the writing right now is amazing. Like, if you're not subscribed to The Punisher and you like sort of the heroes with gunplay, you like flawed characters that get hurt, you like quick one-liners, you like really good art, and you're not subscribed to The Punisher, I don't know what you're doing. Granted, I favor guns in my comics, so I do like The Punisher. But so this picks up where the Punisher has been hunting Hydra because he's angry over the fallout from the Secret Empire.
Yeah,
Captain Hydra from Secret Empire. And so he's killed the Mandarin. And at the beginning of the last book, or the end of the last book, we see that the Mandarin's protege, I forget his name, but he shows up there with the rings. And, oh Lord, it is so good what happens in this book. As you can imagine, if you are not seasoned at using something like, say, magic rings, and you go up against the Punisher, who is pretty seasoned at killing people, it's going to turn out about as bad as you expect it to.
Excellent.
Yes, it is excellent. And there's a surprise ending. The ending, I was a little shocked by what happened, and a little disappointed by a mainstay Marvel character. I'm kind of bummed about it, but... Nonetheless, I think it was bound to happen. It's sort of fallout from the whole Punisher War Machine event, where Punisher War Machine's armor and ran around, and he was ignoring the advice of a certain person who kept telling him to knock that crap off.
Okay.
And that blows up in his face.
Well, then.
So, I can't go any more from there. If you've been following these events, you know what I'm talking about. And if not, well, you'll have to read Punisher, because that book is great. Like, you need to sub to that book. Next, we're going to talk about Livewire, and I think that we should also take a moment to talk about some other things, because not only is Marvel paying tribute to Stan Lee, but Valiant Comics is, too, and quite a few other comics are, too. I noticed there's quite a few that put tributes to Stan Lee, for good reason. So we're going to go back into this. So Livewire is a villain in the Valiant universe, and, well... I don't know if villain's a good anti-hero. I don't know. She works in her own best interest a lot, like Superior Octopus Spider-Man.
Okay.
So she's turning over a new leaf and getting her own book, and some people totally hate her, and some people don't. And the thing about it is, like, she has control of tech, and she has control of electrical power, like electricity powers, and she does like a lot of calculations, so she reasons stuff out in a very like engineer style manner, and I like that about her. I like that. I wouldn't say it's the strongest showing. The art was, I'm sort of on the fence with. I don't know something about it. It wasn't as vibrant as I'd hoped for, I guess, is a nice way of putting it. But it's not bad, and it's a good showing for a number one. And if you like Valiant Comics, you know who you are, you're probably going to go out and pick this up. I would say it's a darn good time, and I'd like to see more from this hero. So next, we're going to talk about Infinity Wars, number 6. And I swore I wasn't going to talk about these books, right?
Yeah.
Like, I was like, yeah. I have event fatigue from Infinity Wars, and I'm tired. And yet, here we are. And I decided I was going to read the last, almost the last book. I think there's one more book. There's one more book beyond this. But I was going to read the wrap-up for Infinity Wars. So basically, if you don't know what happened, Gamora stole all the stones. She folded the universe in on itself, combining a lot of people, and then put them in the Soul Stone. And the Soul Stone was basically supposed to devour the whole universe and everybody inside of it, and then she was going to remake creation in her image. So she was basically doing some angry god stuff. But it was because she wasn't whole from some stuff that happened. And she killed Thanos.
Yeah, like right off the bat.
Murdered him, yeah. Like cold blood murdered. She was calling herself Requiem. So this is the wrap-up of that event and how they deal with Gamora. And the comic before, Loki had gotten all the stones, and he had tricked other people into thinking they had the stones, and so he had taken all of them. Mm-hmm. And it sort of starts with that, and Loki does some rather unexpected stuff. Stuff I wasn't entirely... I mean, it's very out of character. And I gotta tell you, the way they wrapped it up is sort of weird. Like, I wasn't happy about it, but I'm not angry about it. I mean, there's room to grow. I don't think that they're going to be ending the Infinity Wars anytime soon. I think they're setting it up to do this, like, long term.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Yeah. The stones are going to be, like, sort of players. And I don't know. Like, yeah, so I can't say much without spoiling it. But it doesn't feel like it's the end. It's the end of the event, but it's not the end of the story. I think there's going to be more books tied to this. And Loki's done... Not Loki. Adam Warlock has done something that is going to change the face of the universe with the Infinity Stones.
Interesting.
Yeah. So it's really, really interesting. And I think it's a good talking point for a lot of conversations involving the Marvel Universe and OP-ness. But... overpoweredness. Like, that's what I meant by yeah, it didn't sound right.
Yeah.
But so I don't know. It's a good talking point. I think you kind of should read this if you're a Marvel fan, because it'll give you a lot of conversations. At the same time, didn't have a good time with the event. The event was too weird. I think it was too gimmicky. However, this brings us to another Infinity Wars book, Fallen Guardian.
Okay.
And I had a really good time with this book. Really good time with this book. One of the Guardians has died. And you should read this.
So it ties in, huh?
I don't know if died is the right word. It ties in.
From a certain point of view?
Yeah. Okay. I don't know. And I probably shouldn't have even said that. You should read this first, then read this, because that's the order it goes in. I read it out of order and was wholly confused. But, it's really, really touching. And I don't know, maybe I'm just really partial to Star-Lord and Rocket and most of this team of Guardians. But it was touching. I had a good time. I really want to see more. I want to see them go further from this. But it feels like this is a wrap-up on these Guardians, because we know it's coming. Okay, so we pretty much had to re-cock a whole thing, and we're going to have to redo a whole thing. We got a lot of customers in here, which is a good thing. So we made a lot of sales, but at the same time, I'm pretty sure the sound quality was really bad, and something got cut short. So we're just going to redo all these. And I think I was talking about Infinity Wars, Fallen Guardian. It's weird, because I went through like 10 books.
Yeah.
So I'm sort of reliving this. So this book was really, really good. And you should read them in this order. You should read this one first, then this one. This one, basically, there's... I don't know how much I can say without spoiling it. But you can tell from Fallen Guardian, maybe something's happened. And let's just go from there. It was touching. It was beautiful. I had a good time with it. One of the things about it, though, is I think that this team is sort of cycling out, and the new Guardians are cycling in, which is really sad. hits my heart.
Yeah, but the new team.
The new team is great, right? There's like Nova Star, Cosmic Ghost Rider, Beta Ray Bill, which Beta Ray Bill does not get enough love. I love Beta Ray Bill.
He's a heavy hitter.
Yeah, I don't see him in enough books. So Beta Ray Bill needs more respect, and he's going to get it in the New Guardians. So is that what it's called? It's not called New Guardians. That's like a DC thing. That was when Kyle Rayner was running around like Power Rangers with one person from each core. Excuse me. Yeah, I don't know what it's called. Is it called New Guardians of the Galaxy? That's probably what it's called.
I will insert it right here.
Yeah, okay.
Okay.
There you go. next, we're going to talk about Justice League. So Justice League is dealing with the Source Wall has been destroyed. There was this thing called the Totality. They got it originally, then Lex stole it, and it sort of picks up from there. Some of them have split off and gone to Hawkworld. Now, Hawkworld is a world that sort of appears in multiple places in the universe and is never quite fully in one of them, I guess, is the way it's sort of explained. So the Guardians that head the Green Lantern Corps, they know about Hawkworld. They touch on that in this. They know about it, but there's not much they can do about it. And it's sort of weird. It's a weird place of weird. It plays weird with time and space, I guess, is a nice way to put it. And something's going on with the timeline to begin with. Because, first of all, Hawkgirl has lived a bunch of lives because she was cursed for a long time. And one of the lives is one of the people they encounter. And she doesn't remember everything they're doing and doesn't recall any of that. And it's like, it's a different timeline or something's different. Something's changed. And maybe it's the curse breaking. Who knows? But something's changed. And so they're dealing with that. And then at the same time, like back on Earth, Batman does this most insane thing I've ever seen him do. So what's going on is, there's a character called Starro that was like the Justice League originally fought. It was like the Justice League's first villain. And so what happened was they had cut up part of Starro, and Batman had put him in a jar and called him Jarro and raised him as his own. So I don't know. Does Jarro count as a Robin? It kind of seems like he counts as a Robin. Like he calls him Dad, and he's all happy, you know, to help. And it's really funny. Like Batman even at one point...
He would be part of the Bat family.
Yeah, kind of, right? But, like, at one point in Drowned Earth, like, Jarl's like, I'm scared, Dad. And he's like, it's okay. It's gonna be okay. Like, he's like, legitimately worried. I like Jarl. So, what happens was, Starman reappeared. Lex Luthor had done something to him. I think he had overloaded him. And basically, Starman had some info. But he didn't have the means to communicate. So, Batman, you've got somebody like Starman who is ridiculously OP. Super OP, I think. And
telepathic and all?
Yeah, well, a lot of powers. I can't remember them all. And Batman goes and puts Jarro on his face to, like... And Jarro is a telepathic creature that has super telepathy and can amplify stuff. And it basically, what he's doing almost kills him. So Batman's trying to get to the bottom of something, and he does something that almost kills him. Like, the rest of the Justice League comes in, and they're like, what are you doing, you nutso? like pulling Jarro away.
Calm down, Bats.
Yeah, I was like, whoa, Batman, I understand you want to get to the bottom of it, but geez, you're going a little far. And that's, like, the very beginning of the book, so I didn't really spoil anything for you beyond that. Justice League is ramping up, and I'm having a good time with Justice League. But, again, we always say this, I'm very DC biased. God, I really need to clear my throat, man. I'm sorry, let me take a drink. We had a lot of chaos in here, and I already ran through most of this, so I'm doing it again. Next is Princeless. Princeless is, I like the art. Princeless's art reminds me of a Saturday morning cartoon, and I had a good time with it. The story it's very fantasy-themed, it's fantasy motifs, and I think the whole Princeless tagline is that she's a princess, and she doesn't need a prince to save her. She saves herself. And so the story's pretty good. There's, like, transforming animals, there's sword fights, there's guys with cool armor, there's people that, I guess, they transform into wolves and transform into dragons, and it's a very wild story. But this story is not aimed at me, and I don't recommend anyone who is my age go out and pick up this book. I would say if you've got a kid if you have a daughter and she's, like, between 12 and 16, or even a son, I think a son would have a good time with Princeless.
Like a
tween sort of thing. This is sort of a tween book. It's by Action Lab, which I haven't heard too much from Action Lab these days. But anyway, so a good book for a young adult. Next, we're going to talk about Freedom Fighters. And we had we had Kevin Andrew Murphy in here, mm-hmm. and I let Kevin Andrew Murphy look at this book right after I looked at this book, just because I wanted his take on it. And we had very different takes. I mean, so, okay, I fully agree that the Nazis in this book are very campy. Mm-hmm. But
stereotypical bad
guy. Yeah, like, we have ways of making you talk. Like, but I had a good time with those villains. And we should talk about the storyline first. So basically, this is an alternate history storyline. And in it, the Nazis won World War II by using metahumans to win the battle. So the Nazis use metahumans to win the battle, and they've taken over America. And the American resistance is fighting back. And the leader of the resistance is Jesse Owens, the guy who won the Olympics and shamed Hitler. So there's that. And there's other characters in here. I really like the Uncle Sam character, who, like, legitimately looks like Uncle Sam. And when he fights, at one point he's fighting and he says, "Old soldiers never die, you son of a blank. They just fade away." And, like,
it's salty vet.
Yeah. I had a good time with this book. So basically, they can't call them Nazis. I think it's a very PC thing. I don't know if it's a PC thing. They're worried about offending people.
Could just be trying to, like, draw
people.
Attention away from the name so that we can focus on the stories.
Yeah, could be. But they're calling them Ratsies, which is... I think that name draws more attention than Nazis. But I like the name. I think that's a good name for them. Call them Ratsies. Because, frankly, I have a fear of rats. I don't like rats. And that makes them gross to me. It's perfect. Okay. So they call them Ratsies. The symbol is like a warped swastika. It doesn't, like, look like a normal swastika. Okay. I think it's a PC thing. I don't know. Politically correct thing. Nonetheless, so basically these heroes fought. They lost. Most of them died. Uncle Sam disappeared. Ooh. And then 50 years later, they pick up where they left off. And new heroes appear that have similar powers. And they're going to go fight the Nazis.
They're going to fight the Ratsies.
And one thing that Kevin Andrew Murphy pointed out, and I agree with, is it's kind of lazy writing. That, like, 50 years have passed, and then the Ratsies are still exactly the same in their mannerisms and the way they talk and their attitudes.
No development
at all. And I agree, it's kind of lazy writing, but it works for a comic like this, I think. So I had a good time with it, but your mileage may vary. I think it's a number one, and you should probably go pick it up.
Just familiar, though.
It seems super familiar. I can't remember what from. Next, we're going to talk about Shuri. Shuri is on issue number 3.
Yep.
And so basically, how do we wrap this up? T'Challa's missing. He's in an interstellar Wakanda conflict.
With M'Baku.
Lost in space with M'Baku. M'Baku's rebellion. And so Shuri has been offered the mantle of Black Panther, and she has turned it down, oddly enough. She's doing her own thing. And it makes sense. She's back from the Nether Realm. We have people talking loud in them. Oh my god! And she's back from the Nether Realm. She can change into a flock of crows at will.
What?
Yeah, it's really cool. It's a really cool effect. I think it's a cool power. She sees her ancestors talking. The ancestor spirits are, like, talking to her directly. So she's really cool. She's got, like, a lot of cool powers, and she's trying to figure out what happened to her brother. So she goes, she teams up with Storm at one point, and she astrally projects herself across time and space, trying to figure out where her brother's at in space, and winds up inside of Groot.
Wow.
And yeah, it goes from there. It gets super weird from there. The thing about it, though, was I had a good time. I think it doesn't expand much on the story. I think it was a wholly skippable thing.
Uh-huh.
It didn't really affect growth in the story at all.
You get to see some cool quirks, right?
It's like a side quest.
Okay.
Like a side quest. But it was a good side quest. I still had a lot of fun with it. It was campy at times, but it was fun. This Shuri book is honestly one of the best things that Marvel has going right now. The art is absurdly good. Like, I have a really good time with the art. It's not too gritty, and it's fun, and it's drawn well, and the story kind of sucks me in. And I'm saying this as somebody who is primarily a DC fanboy. I have a really good time with these Shuri books. This is only book 3, so I can't wait to see more. I can't recommend it enough. Next, we're going to talk about Pearl. Pearl is a story about a tattoo artist that also has ties to the Yakuza, one of the clans of the Yakuza. And she inadvertently breaks up a gunfight with another clan, ties, or gets involved in a gunfight, I think it was. And She doesn't kill someone she's supposed to because she's also an assassin. And it goes sour from there. She actually falls in love with the guy that she's supposed to kill. So pretty weird story, but pretty good story. And the thing that sells you the most about this, first of all, it's Bendis. And Bendis is really good at writing dialogue and writing characters that are believable. And these ones totally suck you in. Second of all, the other big thing about it is the art. And the art is, oh my god, the best art I've seen in so long. And I think it's primarily watercolors, although I can't say for certain. It might be watercolors with like some photographic thing.
Yeah, very, very artsy.
Maybe it's watercolors over a photo. It really, it's a really unique style, and it's cool. And this is a shot of the Golden Gate Bridge in the book. My god. So I don't know, if you like art, if you buy comics for the art, like I often do, this book is something you can't miss. It's probably the best kept secret on Jinx World right now, because not everyone is talking about it, which is weird, but this book is great. Mm-hmm. So yeah, Pearl by Bendis and Gaidos, and I think everybody should go out and buy this, specifically because the art in this book, this is probably the best showing. Save for the second one, they had like a dance club scene, and the art, they did the watercolor frames outside of the frames, like different shades and different brightness, and they did it inside of the frames, and it really felt like that bright sort of discotheque feel. Nice. And I like that one. However, I would say this is the second best showing of this whole series. So this is book 5, Pearl, go out and buy it. All right. Next is Hardcore. Hardcore is a Image number 1. I can't say Image first, because those are like different books, but yeah. Image number 1. Hardcore is very cyberpunky, very futury. The story's weird. So it's about, basically, they've taken nanotechnology and they figured out how to, they will basically set up a team and go out and snipe someone, and they won't shoot them with bullets, they'll shoot them with nanotechnology. And that nanotechnology takes control of the nervous system and then gives a person remotely the ability to turn a person into like a human drone and control a person. And so then they use that to get close to bad guys to assassinate them. And I don't think it is said. Hi.
She came and restocked. Oh. She came to my store.
Oh, okay.
She came into my store and I was like, I have to go see.
Oh.
Are you guys
doing
something?
Yeah.
It's okay.
It's okay.
I can cut this out.
I ran right into your shop. I'm sorry about that.
That's all right. It's okay.
I'm going to stop it.
Should we talk about it?
Okay, yeah, let's talk about it. Okay. That's okay.
So we got interrupted. She didn't know we were doing something, but that was another employee from another mall store that was super excited because we sell six soaps. We sell six soaps here, and six soaps...
What's her
name again? Shayna.
Yeah.
She makes these really cool soaps, like this is Freddy Krueger. And so everybody like comes to our store to buy her soaps, and she just restocked. So one of the other employees like ran in all excited and was like all excited. And was like, "Oh, are you doing something?"
Was, like, I don't know. We may keep that in there.
Yeah, we're gonna keep that in.
Yeah,
probably.
She said it was okay.
Oh man.
Whew, you okay?
Yeah, I need to eat something. Like, I need to eat and drink something. My throat's going.
Take 12.
It feels like this never ends. Okay, so we were talking about Hardcore, and they were like turning people into human drones.
Right.
And then they were using it to assassinate people. And it doesn't say that it's the U.S. government, but they mentioned soldiers, and it looks very high-tech U.S.-y. So
Big Brother-y.
Maybe.
Yeah.
It's very cyberpunk-themed. Like, obviously, the story's cyberpunk-themed. And I'm sure you can see it coming. It's a little tropey, but basically they spell it out that, hey, if you get locked in a body for a long time, like, you'll get brain damage and you'll die. So what do you think happens at the end of the story?
Somebody gets locked
in their body. Right?
Oh, yeah. Oh, foreshadowing! Oh.
So maybe I spoiled a little, I'm sorry, I'm sure you can see it coming. So it's weird. I like the story, I want to see where it goes. I'm not totally sold on the art. The art is, it's almost too gritty, which is weird to say because, like, I think Transmet is pretty gritty, and yet I had an awesome time with Transmet, so I don't know. I'm not totally sold on the art, and I'm not entirely sure why, which is really weird because the back has, like, this crazy glitch art thing, and I love glitch art, so I don't know. I don't know. Something about the art sort of, I'm going to wait and see more. I want to see more from that book, so I'll trip report it next time, brother.
Don't die, man.
Man, I gotta clear my throat.
Or die. We're recording. We're live.
We're recording. Maybe we'll get some more clicks. I don't know. We might get 10 subscribers.
Whoa! Double digits.
No, I don't even know how many we have. I haven't checked.
And those who do subscribe, thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Like and subscribe.
Yes.
Isn't comments that what they always say? They always say that, like, at the beginning.
Don't forget to like and subscribe.
Don't forget to like and subscribe our video. We never say that. We're like, let's just make a video and talk about comics.
Remember to hit the bell icon. I think we said it one time. Yeah.
Did we?
Yeah.
Okay.
That's all right. All right.
That's cool.
All right.
So, next, we're going to talk about X-Force. X-Force is, are you ready for it?
Uh-huh.
Really good.
Oh.
Really good.
DC Fanboy says really good.
Really, really good.
I'll take that.
The art of this book is amazing. The way the dialogue is written, like there's an exchange between like Nathan Summers and Deathlok, and it plays out really well. It's really well written. I like the characters. The characters are terribly flawed. Obviously, they're on X-Force.
Mm-hmm.
And
I think that's part of the appeal,
totally
too.
Totally sold me on it. In fact, this one girl, I forget her name, oh god, it's gonna drive me nuts, but she basically makes fire that can explode. She says, like, tick, tick, boom at one point and throws it at somebody, and I was like, oh,
nice, yeah.
If I had that power, that's what I would say.
Mm-hmm.
So anyways, the dialogue sold me on it, the art sold me on it. It was a really, really good book and a fun run.
Nice.
I had fun.
Okay.
I want to know more about it. Oh, this time they're being led by Domino. I seem to remember her leading me before, but I'm not sure if that was a dream or real.
Yeah.
Next, we're going to talk about Firefly. This is the second book. This takes place after the events of Firefly, so the team has grown together, before Serenity, so Wash and Shepard are both alive.
Oh.
And really, really good book. Super good book. I don't know how much I can spoil, but I think I talked too much about it on the last take, so I'm not going to talk that much about it. Basically, they're doing a mission, they're trying to raise money, they're low on funds, which is pretty typical in the Firefly universe. So they've taken a mission where they're escorting like people to their holy site, and both the people don't seem to want to fight, the bandits don't seem to want to fight, but they all talk a big game, but they all, like, it seems like the people that are religious, that don't want to fight and refuse to fight, are really bloodthirsty in trying to provoke the people guarding them to fight.
Oh, wow.
It's pretty bad. I'm sure it's like a statement on our times.
Mm.
But the way this plays out is really good. And I don't want to spoil it, but there's an exchange between, oh, it's okay, man. You know, you got a phone call. There is an exchange between Wash and his wife, and it plays out exactly how it's supposed to play out. What's Wash's wife's name? It's Mel, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, I always forget. I forget names. But so Wash and Mel have this exchange at the end of the book, and it's so perfect. It's so Firefly. It's like Joss Whedon wrote that whole scene. It was beautiful.
Awesome.
And it's
awesome.
Greg Pak. So Greg Pak is doing this series great justice. Next, we're going to talk about Marvel Superhero Adventures, and this is one that I said I was going to review for the kids.
Yeah.
For the kids.
It's for the kids.
So this is a great book, oddly enough. I didn't think I would have that much fun with this book. It's divided into like three different stories. At one point, there's like this Rainbow Road maze, which is kind of cool to see.
The old
Marvel
stuff.
I haven't seen
stuff,
that sort of stuff in like a comic in a while. And then probably the best part is there's a page of the Daily Bugle comic section. And it has like Spider-Man, but that's clearly Peanuts.
Oh my god.
Yeah, it has Hagar, but it's Hella the Horrible.
Is that Dilbert for J. Jonah Jameson?
It is Dilbert for J. Jonah Jameson. It absolutely is. Hopefully it says, give me pictures of Spider-Man, but I don't know if it does. And then it's got Little Orphan Ant-Man.
Dog!
So, I oddly enough had a really, really good time with this Marvel Superheroes Adventures.
What?
I've never read these before. but if you got a kid who's age, I don't know, 9 to 14 maybe...
Or an adult with that kind of sense
of
humor.
Or an adult with that
this
sense of humor. Somebody who wants to throw back to those old sort of campy activity book comics. You will have a really good time with this book, I think.
I can't believe they went there.
Yeah, those comics are pretty funny. Next is Spawn, and we need to talk this up for a minute. So, I have liked Spawn, but I have a sort of love-hate relationship with Spawn. I don't know if I always like the politics of heaven and hell in my comics. It's sort of been an iffy ground with me. However, Spawn has always been drawn really beautifully, and right now they're really doing it justice because the guy who's drawing it, or who's a, yeah, the guy who's drawing it is Seizmon Kudransky. Hopefully I pronounced his name right. I never know if I'm pronouncing it right. But he's the guy who is drawing, or who is doing the art for Punisher.
Mm-hmm.
And it's very Punisher-esque. In fact, I think at one point, like, this guy looks a lot how the Punisher looks right now.
Oh, wow, yeah.
Yeah. So, the storyline is basically, Spawn has, it's picked up from where Spawn left off. Spawn has locked both heaven and hell out of Earth. Has also locked all the angels and demons who are on Earth into Earth. And they're all a little pissed. And I think that's an understatement. Meanwhile, Spawn is discovering new powers. He's sort of forging new powers. He's got the ability to bring people back to the dead, bring people back from the dead,
mm-hmm.
and kill them again, like instantly.
Nice, nice.
So he has some control over the dead. I guess this is a throwback to the original Spawn, who had control over the damned. So that's why they kept the Spawn line going, because they realized they were really powerful,
mm-hmm.
but they couldn't control them. And this is apparently all of the Spawns do this, they say. So we'll see where it goes from here.
Excellent.
But yeah, I'm having a good time with it. I would say the story is a little iffy for me. I know it's Todd McFarlane. I don't know. It's a little sort of
preachy.
No, I don't even want to say preachy. It's just at times it's a little confusing. Maybe there's almost too much dialogue, which is weird. But I don't know.
It happens.
It gets a little convoluted at times. Doesn't mean I hate it. It's hard to hate Spawn, especially when the art is that beautiful. But yeah, I'm all right. Tom McFarlane's writing it, right?
Yep.
I don't know. I think you should go out and pick up Spawn. Spawn number 292. Yep. Yeah, I mean, the cover alone is really gorgeous.
Yes.
This book is totally worth buying.
And he's going to be directing the other Spawn that's coming out.
Oh, is he?
Yes.
Directing.
Todd McFarlane is
directing. I didn't know he could, but he's going.
He does everything, apparently. Yeah. He writes.
He makes toys. Yeah.
He makes toys, yeah. Todd McFarlane, man of our age.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know what I'm saying anymore. We're almost to the point where we left off.
Yay!
Yay! Something's going to happen. Like, the camera's going to explode. Okay, so this is the all-new Aquaman Part 1, and this is in Unspoken Waters. So the events of Drowned Earth wrapped up,
okay,
and Aquaman was seen on some shore that, you know, was away from the rest of the Justice League. They couldn't find him.
Okay.
So I don't want to elaborate too much, but basically it's a very seafarer's tale. He's washed up on some unknown shore,
uh-huh.
and the ocean is weird there. The people there are very, like, they believe in superstition and myth. And all of them were washed up there, and they can't explain it.
Oh.
And it sort of picks up from there. And it's really quite good. Like, I had a good time with it. It's weird. There's not a lot of action in the story, but it's building towards something that sort of feels very folk-like.
Yeah, the hamster wheel in my head is really spinning right now.
It's very folk-tale-ish. And it's kinda not like uncommon for an Aquaman story.
Like an Odyssey kind of thing?
Yeah, kind of.
Huh.
Not
to be confused with Justice League Odyssey.
Okay, if you're a DC fan, you're going to probably want to go pick this up. If you're an Aquaman fan, of course you're going to pick this up. Marvel fan, I don't know. You got the Defenders and Namor right now, so
yes.
I think you should be rocking that. Next, we're going to talk about Season Beatings.
Yeah,
number
my
one.
Boy Deadpool.
So this is the Deadpool Holiday Special, not to be confused with the last Deadpool comic, which was the Deadpool Holiday Special. I'm really confused right here. It had Deadpool hijacking Santa's sleigh.
Yeah, I saw that.
Yeah, and then we've got Season's Beatings, the Deadpool.
Mm-hmm.
Deadpool's heading this holiday book, and it basically opens with Deadpool. And one of the things he says is very profound. It says questions like, is Wade wearing a Santa suit covered in not-so-dry blood? Of course, this time of year, we're all wearing this on the inside, are we not?
Ooh.
Wow.
With
so,
the snarkiness.
Yeah, the Deadpool snarkiness is here. It's good. The cutaway stories, I think there's like three or four stories. The first one, really, really good showing about Peter Parker and Miles dealing with stuff. Had a good time with that. The second one was Squirrel Girl. Did not have the best time with that story. But, you know, third story was, it was okay. I think the middle story was kind of a little forgettable. But whatever. It's a holiday special. But it's Deadpool. Okay. So it doesn't feel like a genuine sort of like seasonal
holiday,
heartwarming type.
Like that X-Men one? Or,
yeah. It's like Deadpool puts his fingers on it and makes it all sort of
Deadpool-y.
Deadpool-y. Yeah. So it's good. If you like Deadpool, you should pick this up.
Okay.
If you like Deadpool, you should pick this up. If you like holiday specials, you should probably pick up a different holiday special. It's not very heartwarming, I guess you could say. Or maybe it is. I don't know. It's kind of, it depends on your take. Next, we're going to talk about Batman. And it's hard to talk about this book without spoiling it.
Oh, man. Mm. Tom King is killing it with Batman right now.
So, let's talk about the last Batman book. So, we knew Thomas Wayne was in the play.
Mm-hmm.
We knew Thomas Wayne was in the play. He was shown standing next to Bane, three books ago? Four books ago?
Yep. It's no big spoiler there.
No big spoiler there. At the end of the last book, Thomas Wayne appeared.
Yep.
And there was some violence.
There was some violence.
That is not resolved in this one. At all.
Ooh.
Not resolved. 100% not resolved.
Okay.
Although, I don't know. Was it Thomas Wayne?
Okay.
Ooh. We got theories.
Wait a second.
We need to talk off camera.
Yes,
about
yes,
this.
We do.
Talk off camera. In the meantime, so this story takes place, and it's basically, it shows Bruce as a child going through the throes of dealing with what happens when your parents are killed. And it goes from there, and it gets weirder and weirder and weirder. And I can't really talk about it without spoiling it. However, is it good? It's really, really good. It introduces a character I didn't know existed before that. I'm not sure where this character came from. We had a talk about this.
Yeah,
character.
I know. And I want to pick your mind on it, that would be a spoiler.
I don't think that this character is something that Bane did, but maybe it is.
Because we don't know the time period, right?
Yeah, we don't know the time period. We don't know when this takes place, at least in the book. And I wouldn't say that Bane is above doing something like this.
No.
But it seems terribly out of character. I would think that for this character to occur, the person that would cause this would probably be more like Zax.
Okay.
Maybe even the Joker.
Yeah, because that's where my head first went.
Yeah, but...
Because I haven't seen him in this.
Yeah, so if you're a Batman fan or a DC fan, if you're a DC and Batman fan, I don't know why you're not reading Batman right now. Maybe you don't like Tom King. I have encountered people who don't like Tom King. I don't know. I think what Tom King is doing, and this is just my personal take, I think he is returning Bane to the level where he was in Nightfall, where you were frightened of Bane, where you were scared to death of Bane. Because Nightfall, Bane broke Bat's back, and then it was just mostly Ozbats running around for like a long time.
Yep.
And I love Ozbats. Azbats.
Azbats.
I love Azbats. However, I was genuinely scared of Bane back then, and then for a long time, people made him very campy and cheesy.
Oh, God.
And he was just like the luchador running around being cheesy and freaking out on drugs. He wasn't a good character. He wasn't a good villain. Now, however, I'm very scared of Bane. I think we had to talk about it, but those last five, maybe six books that they put out, I have been wholly scared. I think ever since what happened to Nightwing getting shot in the head, I have been completely frightened
that
every
made
single
it super
time
real.
I pick up one of these books.
Yeah.
Like, scared to death. And I'm more scared of Bane right now than I am the Batman Who Laughs. Okay? That villain creeps me out way more than the Batman Who Laughs. Bane does. Mm-hmm. And so, I'm anxious to see where it goes. And we all know from the very beginning of this run, they said that Batman's going to die. I think it was implied.
Yep.
Whether or not it works out that way. But they've officially announced it. How many books does King have? 100 books.
Yeah.
100 books to kill Batman. And we're only on 61. So if he keeps playing this out and the whole thing is just the theme of Bane screwing him over, it's going to be so good.
Yes.
So good. So I hope it keeps going. And we're dealing with King. King was a CIA analyst.
Yeah, I think so.
He was
so.
A CIA analyst. So this man knows some plotting. He's pretty good at plotting, I have to say. So I think a lot of people are missing the point of King's Run. I don't think the point of King's Run is necessarily to kill Batman, is necessarily to champion Batman. I think it's to make Bane really, really scary. And he's done that. It creeps me out. So some people have, like, serious problems with this run. I'm having the best time of anything I've read comics-wise, ever. I'm having the best time.
Best of times, the worst of times.
Okay. So anyways, that was my rambling about Batman. I didn't really tell you much about this book. It introduces a really cool character. It's really good. I had a good time with this book. I don't know why you're not reading Batman.
So, we didn't say goodbye or anything.
We didn't say goodbye. We didn't say goodbye. It's been a weird week. It's been a really busy week for us. And at the same time, like, we have to keep extra hours here so we're tired. You see these circles under my eyes? Oh, my God. I look like I've been a superhero out fighting crime at night because I'm getting no sleep.
I know.
But anyway, so it's been a good week. Happy holidays from Green Machine. We love you all. And thank you to all our friends and family who support us and put up with us while we're chasing our dream. And thank you to every single one of our customers who come in here and help us.
Yeah.
We appreciate you all very, very much. Thank you.
Yeah.
Happy holidays. Happy New Year.
Do the dance!
Oh, do the dance.